Merry Christmas. This next song is the song of the birds. It's in an old form of Catalonian, and it basically says each bird comes to the wonderful understanding that there's a new light on the earth, and each bird tells its song. And they talk about kindness, joy, spirit, and humanity coming on earth through Jesus Christ.
Oh. sei de spai, vamos a resvolar, col donna maludia. shall speak peace on the The ox and the sun.
Good evening. Welcome to our online Christmas Eve service at the First Unitarian Church of Worcester, Massachusetts. I'm Sarah Stewart. I'm the minister here. It's wonderful to have all of you with us this evening. I'm leading worship this evening with our Director of Music, Will Sherwood, our Director of Faith Development, Juliette Donaldson, and our Assistant Director of Music, James Haupt. Andrew Donaldson is volunteering as our camera operator. We are very pleased to have special guest musicians here as well. Charlotte Russell, soprano, Mason Tran, oboe, Patrick Chatham, cello. Maria Ferrante, soprano, recorded videos for us ahead of time, and we'll have footage of our own First Unitarian Choir from last year's Christmas Eve service. Here at First Unitarian Church, we strive in loving fellowship to honor the sacred, connect with each other, and serve justice. We are a welcoming congregation. Whatever your age, race, class, nationality, sexual orientation, or gender identity, we are delighted to have you with us. We are thinking of all of you with compassion during this difficult time when we cannot be together in person. This evening's service will conclude with our traditional candle lighting featuring our choir recorded last year during the Christmas Eve service. You may want to have candles ready to light when we reach that part of the service, so go ahead and get those now if you don't have them already. Like this video and subscribe to our channel to help others find our community. You can stay connected to the church through our website, firstunitarian.com, our Facebook page, and our newsletter. The newsletter is the best way to keep up with everything that's going on in the church. If you would like to receive our e-newsletter, please go to firstunitarian.com and click subscribe to our newsletter at the bottom of any page. We welcome you this holy night. May the spirit of this season help us find our way through the noise and the turmoil of the days ahead into the heart of Christmas itself, to its quieter joy and its peace. May we learn that we cannot hear the songs until our own hearts learn to sing them. May we, whose needs are so great, know how close we are to what we seek, and how often the things we want so desperately are ours already. May we be strong enough for the joys and the pains of love, and may we, with quiet persistence in our hearts, learn to enjoy the small happenings of our days and hours and find in them the meaning that touches us most deeply, that moves us most profoundly. May we find the goodness in life. Amen.
Thank you.
We light our Advent candles for peace, hope, joy, and love. A candle for peace in our hearts, our homes, our neighborhoods, our nation, and our world. A candle for hope for the discoveries of science and renewed community in the new year. A candle of joy for new life, new possibility, new connections, and new understandings. A candle of love for those we hold in our hearts, whom death has taken or distance separates. We light candles this Advent night.
Starlight flies.
The 96th Psalm. Oh, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord, bless his name. Tell of his salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous works among the peoples. For great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. He is to be revered above all gods. For all the gods of the peoples are idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Honor and majesty are before him. Strength and beauty are in his sanctuary. Ascribe to the Lord, O families of the peoples. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come into his courts. Worship the Lord in holy splendor. Tremble before him, all the earth. Say among the nations, the Lord is king. The world is firmly established. It shall never be moved. He will judge the peoples with equity. Let the heavens be glad and let the earth rejoice. Let the sea roar and all that fills it. Let the field exult and everything in it. Then shall all the trees of the forest sing for joy before the Lord, for he is coming. For he is coming to judge the earth. He will judge the world with righteousness and the peoples with his truth.
The Adoration of the Wise Men by Cecil Frances Alexander. Saw you never in the twilight, when the sun had left the skies, up in heaven the clear stars shining through the gloom like silver eyes? So of old the wise men watching saw a little stranger star, and they knew the king was given, and they followed it from far. Heard you never of the story, how they crossed the desert wild, journeyed on by plain and mountain, till they found the Holy Child? How they opened all their treasure, kneeling to that infant king, gave the gold and fragrant incense, gave the myrrh in offering? Know ye not that lowly baby was the bright and morning star, he who came to light the Gentiles and the darkened isles afar? And we may too seek his cradle. There our hearts best treasures bring, love and faith and true devotion for our Savior, God and King. A reading from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 2. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child. And she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flocks by night. Then an angel of the Holy One stood before them, and the glory of the Eternal shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Great One. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace, goodwill among people." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said one to another, "Let us not go to Bethlehem and see the thing that has taken place, which the Holy One has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds had told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, as it had been told them. Blessed be.
Son of me.
From the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 2. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem asking, "Where is the child who has been born King of the Jews? For we observed his star at its rising, and we have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel.'" Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word, so that I may also go and pay him homage." When they had heard the king, they set out, and there ahead of them went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they knelt down and paid him homage. Then, opening their treasure chests, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another road. The Work of Christmas by Howard Thurman. when the song of the angels is stilled, when the star in the sky is gone, when the kings and princes are home, when the shepherds are back with their flock, the work of Christmas begins. To find the lost, to heal the broken, to feed the hungry, to release the prisoner, to rebuild the nations, to bring peace among siblings, to make music in the heart. I couldn't see this week's planetary conjunction. It was too cloudy here in Worcester. Maybe there's another chance after Christmas. I saw photos from folks whose skies were less cloudy, an amazingly bright object in the sky, sometimes visible as two planets, sometimes looking like one, shining bigger and brighter than any star, its light steady in the evening sky. Even when we understand the science, the movement of the bodies in our solar system and galaxy bring us wonder and awe. The star the wise men followed to Bethlehem might have been a similar planetary conjunction. Jupiter and Saturn came together in 7 BCE, so perhaps that was Jesus' star. It could also have been a comet in 5 BCE or a supernova. We'll never know. We remember the wise men more for the story they tell than for their historical fact. Their presence in the story shows an overturning of Israel's fortunes. Foreign kings come to bow down before the Hebrew God, before a tiny baby, and they subvert the earthly power of the wicked King Herod. They bring with them the expensive gifts of the grave. Gold, frankincense, and myrrh, which were used to prepare bodies for burial. Their worship foreshadows the end. But like any good story, the Christmas story doesn't have to be factual to be true. In this story, the wise men have true wisdom for us. Imagine the story from their point of view. These wise men were very important people. Sometimes in story and song, we remember them as kings. At the very least, they were important advisors to kings, part of the cabinet or the privy council, the innermost circle. They were foreign ministers visiting Herod, one king to another. They were there to congratulate Herod on the birth of a new Jewish leader. Little did they know how much their plans were about to change. When the wise men found this newborn king and realized that he was just a baby, born to a poor family far from home, and under threat from Herod himself, the most powerful man in Judea, they knew they must change their plans. They had to give up their expectations and their familiar luxury in order to take personal risk on behalf of this ordinary child. Warned in a dream, they went home by a different way. I imagine them taking off their rich robes and the markers of their status. I imagine them reducing their entourage so they can travel incognito, quietly making their way home. I imagine the love and promise of the infant's new life burning bright in their hearts as they put aside their privilege in order to protect the most vulnerable. Before the pandemic, we thought we knew who we were. We thought we understood our identities, and we clung to the social engagements, the memberships, plans, and gatherings that told us what kind of people we were. Then, when the pandemic hit, we were stripped of everything we knew about ourselves. All of a sudden, we were not people who went to work and whose children went to school. We were not people with secure jobs or people who were safe from illness. We were not people who saw our friends and family or knew what the future would hold. Yet I witnessed that we held on to one very important marker of our identities. We were people who helped one another. If this pandemic has made anything clear, it is that we need one another to survive. We need our human community. And we have recreated it through Zoom screens and distanced walks. We wore masks and helped neighbors with grocery runs. Members of this church took risks to help a family move into safe housing. Like the wise men, we knew we had to make some sacrifices in our own comfort and status in order to help one another through this hard time. Getting through the pandemic would mean working together to protect those most in need. Even now, as we enter a new year, still under the cloud of illness, we are called to find our true calling and identity in helping others. The baby in the manger grew up, of course. We know a good deal more about the historical truth of his adulthood than about his birth. Jesus became a healer and a prophet, giving people hope and dignity and proclaiming the kingdom of God on earth. He told his followers that if they wanted to show their love for him, they would show their love to one another. Feed the hungry, he said. Give water to the parched. Welcome the stranger. Clothe the naked. Care for the ill. Visit the imprisoned. You do not need your riches or your routines, your groups or your travels to know who you truly are. You may miss them, but God calls to your very being and invites you into relationship with all of humanity. We know who we are when we care for those who need it most. We know who we are through kindness, compassion, generosity, and mutual sacrifice for the greater good. The pandemic has overturned what we thought mattered for our identities. What is left to each of us is the inherent worth and dignity we have as children of the divine. A promise is born to us this Christmas, that each of us discovers our true humanity in caring for each other. As the wise men traveled home, it was as though they carried the Christ child with them. His tiny infant body was with his parents, of course. But if the wise men had returned to Herod or trumpeted their progress, they would have put that baby in danger. They had to keep his secret. It was as though they held him in their arms. In that same way, the Christ child is in our care this year. When we care for one another, we care for the promise of dignity and well-being against the forces of misery and loss. Let this be the Christmas gift that burns in your heart all year, that in our sacrifices, we care for one another, and we bring about the kingdom of God on earth. I love you all. Amen. We have an opportunity right now to live out our deepest values and honor the divinity in every person by making a donation to support the Interfaith Hospitality Network of Greater Worcester, Worcester's family homeless shelter. IHN provides dignified shelter and housing to families in Worcester, allowing couples to stay together, dads to stay with their kids, and teenage boys to stay with their moms. First Unitarian Church was one of the founding congregations supporting IHN in the late 1990s. When IHN was first founded, we and other congregations actually housed the families in our church and synagogue buildings. Now there's a permanent shelter on June Street, and we continue to provide a major gift from our Christmas Eve collection every year, as well as volunteer to staff the shelter 3 weeks a year. This year, we knew that Christmas Eve service would be all online, and we wouldn't have our beautiful sanctuary filled up with people to ask for a donation to IHN. So as a church, we set a goal for the month of December to raise $6,000, a little more than our usual gift, to support IHN. And I am delighted to tell you that we have met that goal. Thank you to everyone who helped us reach this generous goal. Every gift makes a difference. You may be hearing about this effort to support IHN for the first time, and tonight you have the opportunity to help us do something extraordinary. We all know how hard this year has been, and we know it has been especially hard for families facing eviction, job loss, poverty, and homelessness. IHN's services matter now more than ever. We can come together with donations tonight to make a truly outstanding gift to IHN at the moment when they need it most. I invite your donations to help house our neighbors in Worcester. You can text 844-906-2338, followed by the amount you wish to donate, and your donation tonight will support IHN. You can also go to our website, firstunitarian.com. There is a link to a special donate button on the front page image of the Christmas pageant and on our service and justice page as well. First Unitarian Church will pay any fees associated with your donation so that 100% of your donation will go to IHN to support their family shelter. I invite your generous contributions for this ministry in our community. Thank you.
See.
Now it's time to find your candles and dim your lights if you choose. If you are with friends or family, you may light one another's candles. And as you do, say, may light and new life be yours. Please join me in the unison benediction, which will appear on your screen. We are here this Christmas Eve as one community, to know we are one people, even when we cannot be together. We come to fill our eyes with the light of candles, to fill our ears with the sounds of music, to fill our hearts with the wonder of new hope. So lift your candle into the air, that its soft light may shine upon the night as we remember all those we love. Lift your candles into the air that their soft light may fill your room, that their soft light may shine into the world, so we may know that to witness a miracle, we need only the willingness to pass our light from one to another. Amen.
Words of a cheer from everywhere, filling the air. Oh, the praise of the song, the kingdom of the king.
thank you for worshiping with us tonight. We wish you all a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. We look forward to the day when we can be together once again. Good night.